And turn to 470. I know you got spoiled while I was gone. I'm back. Sweetly, Lord, have we heard thee calling, come follow me. And we see where thy footprints falling lead us to thee. Footsteps of Jesus that make the pathway glow. We will follow the steps of Jesus where'er they go. Though they lead o'er the cold, dark mountain, seeking his sheep, or along by Siloam's fountain, helping the weak. Footprints of Jesus that make the pathway glow. We will follow the steps of Jesus where'er they go. If they lead through the temple holy, preaching the word, or in homes of the poor and lowly, serving the Lord. Footprints of Jesus that make the pathway glow. We will follow the steps of Jesus where'er they go. Then at last, when on high he sees us, our journey done, we will rest where the steps of Jesus ring and his throne. Footprints of Jesus that make the pathway glow. We will follow the steps of Jesus where'er they go.
And good morning, everyone. I'm so glad to see each one of you here at Camp Creek Community Church and our morning worship service. And just so thankful to have this opportunity to gather in the name of our Lord and to worship our Savior in spirit and in truth. And I'm just so thankful for all of our church family and all of our guests that are here this morning. And so welcome. The announcements there in our bulletin, I failed to mention, I'm going to be out of town on Wednesday, so we will not be having our Wednesday evening service. So if you see that in the bulletin, just scratch that out. No Wednesday evening service this week. But we will be having our church service this evening at 6 p.m., you can see in your bulletin, it's called a Pastor Appreciation Social sandwiches, cake, and ice cream. I'd like to turn that around and call it a Congregation Appreciation Social. And so I hope you can come this evening at 6 p.m. We're going to have an abbreviated service, I promise, abbreviated, and we'll have it. Right, we'll just have the entire service right back there in the fellowship hall, and then we'll have a time of food and fellowship to follow. So please come back at 6 p.m. This evening. All right, any other announcements that I need to make this morning? All right, if not, we want to spend some time in prayer to the Lord. I know there are many needs that are represented in this auditorium. I know there are burdens on my heart. We have many prayer requests on our prayer list. And I know there are many others. So if you have a prayer request this morning, any burdens, any praises. Brother Bill.
I'd like for the church to continue to pray for me because I don't know what's going on.
Okay. Not quite up to par.
I feel lightheaded right now. So.
Okay. Well, I'm glad. Glad you're here. Certainly lifting you up in prayer. Many of you have chronic conditions and not knowing what's going on. I know, Sue, you're waiting. You're going to have to wait till December for answers there. And I know there are so many others. So let's just pray for one another. Thankful you're here. Pray for those that are unable to be here. We know there are those that can't be with us because of illness. So we've had a tough go with sickness here of late, and hopefully we can get everybody back healthy and back in fellowship with each other again. Any other prayer requests this morning? Well, as I mentioned, we have many burdens that are in our hearts, and so if you have an unspoken request for prayer, would you lift your hand? And God sees these hands. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Our most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, you are so kind and you are so gracious. We do not deserve your graciousness, your goodness, your kindness, or your love. And you have poured out all these blessings upon us by the offer of your only begotten Son as a sacrifice for our sins, that we could be reconciled to you by faith in Jesus Christ. And for each person here, I trust and I pray that is the situation, that every person knows you, and that full and free pardon of sin. And if they do not, if anyone here or anyone within the sound of my voice does not know you, that today would be that day that you would soften that heart and open the ear, that the gospel would be heard and received, and a soul would be saved. And for these that are saved, I know that there are many burdens here, so many on our prayer list and so many on our hearts. The uplifted hand with the unspoken needs. I say this often, how comforting it is to know that you know intimately each and every need, and you are at work. So for these burdens, especially these unspoken requests, may you grant the answer to our burden according to your perfect will, and give us strength to trust and to serve you. And we also think of the situation of our brethren, especially around the world in places where they do not have the freedom that we so richly enjoy here, that you would be with the saints of God wherever they may be. Give them strength and courage, and give us a burden that we would uplift our brethren that are suffering for your name's sake. For the situation in our country, the spiritual spiral downward that continues, that you would intervene in the church in America, in the lives of individual Christians in America, in my life here, that we would have a renewed vigor to serve you and to be ambassadors for Jesus Christ. And all around the world, there's so much turmoil. The shootings in Maine and the war-torn countries of Ukraine and Israel and other places. And as armies assemble opposed, and the threat of war looms large, help us not to be fearful, but trusting you. We have the only hope that there is in these broken clay pots, the glory of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, His Holy Spirit that indwells us. Help us to shine for you. I pray for this service. Thank you for these that are here, for those that want to be here, and Lord, for those who have chosen not to be here, that you would work. Save the lost, restore the wayward, strengthen the saints for your honor and glory and our eternal good. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
When I saw the cleansing fountain open wide for all my sin, I obeyed the Spirit's wooing when He said, "Wilt thou be clean?" I will praise Him. The Lamb for sinners slain. Give Him glory, all ye people, for His blood can wash away each stain. Though the way seems straight and narrow, all I claimed was swept away. My ambitions, plans, and wishes at my feet in ashes lay. I will praise Him. I will praise Him. Praise the Lamb for sinners slain. Give Him glory, all ye people, for His blood can wash away each stain. Blessed be the name of Jesus. I'm so glad He took me in. He's forgiven my transgressions. He has cleansed my heart from sin. I will praise Him, I will praise Him, praise the Lamb for sinners slain. Give him glory, all ye people, for his blood can wash away each stain. Glory, glory to the Father. Glory, glory to the Son. Glory, glory to the Spirit. Glory to the three in one. I will praise him. I will praise him.
Praise
the Lamb for sinners slain. Give him glory, all ye people, for his blood can wash away each stain.
I love those hymns that are just chock full of the truth of God's word. That's a good one. All right. Well, let's see. Have we had any birthdays this past week or this coming week? Ah, Claire, you had a birthday?
It's Wednesday.
It's Wednesday. All right. Well, happy birthday on Wednesday. That's wonderful. Anyone else celebrating a birthday? All right. Well, this is all about Claire. Let's sing happy birthday to her.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
And also, Wednesday is an anniversary celebration. How many years, Bill?
59.
You hesitated. Good job. You did better than I did last week. I had to use my fingers and count. Happy anniversary to y'all coming up, also Wednesday. Anyone else have an anniversary? All right. 59 years. Let's sing happy anniversary to Bill and Sue.
Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary, God bless you. Happy anniversary to you.
What do you get for your 60th?
Biscuits and gravy.
Biscuit. What is it supposed to be on the 60th, ain't it? Anybody know? Nobody knows?
Find out.
Well, guess we'll look it up. I'll get mom will Google it for us. She'll give us the answer tonight. All right, that's wonderful. It's great to be able to celebrate our birthdays and anniversaries together. What a better place to do it than as we gather in the Lord's house together. All right. Well, at this time, if the ushers will come, let's worship the Lord with our tithes and offerings. Thank you, Brother Randy. Thank you. Can't get you to lead the singing. We'll at least get you to take up the offering. Brother Allen, would you lead us in prayer, please?
Almighty God, Father, we thank you, Lord, for everything that you do for us. We look around and see all the blessings we have, and we thank you. And Lord, we ask that you help us to thank you even more. We ask now that you please watch over all of our families and friends, Lord, and everybody we come in contact with. We hope that you will help us to show them the light, Lord. Yes. We ask now that you please bless this offering. In Christ's holy name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
I hope you was able to listen to that off of Tori and the words, heartaches and broken pieces, ruined lives. Does that apply to anybody here? All of us, doesn't it? That's why he came to die on Calvary. His touch is what I long for. He's given life to me. Amen. Praise the Lord. All right. Well, I see a guitar up here, a guitar. And Sister Gracie is going to come and sing as we prepare our hearts to receive God's word. Sister Gracie.
Yes.
Are you ready? Are there those on your heart that you know are not ready? As Alan prayed about and Gracie sang about, to be ready to meet the Lord and to be ready to give an answer to any man that asks us the reason of the hope that is within us, trembling in fear. Because none of us deserve this great salvation. And it is offered to all who believe. Help us, Lord, to be that witness. This morning, if you have your Bible, let's open up to Nehemiah chapter 4. New chapter in this ongoing study in the book of Nehemiah. For a text this morning, we'll be looking at the first 9 verses, Nehemiah chapter 4, verses 1 through 9. And I would like to read the first and the 9th verse, and then we'll get right into the message this morning. Reading Nehemiah chapter 4, verse 1. But it came to pass that when Sanballat heard that we builded the wall, he was wroth and took great indignation and mocked the Jews. In verse 9, nevertheless, we made our prayer unto our God and set a watch against them day and night because of them. And God added his blessing to the reading of his word. Nehemiah has answered the call of God as the city walls of Jerusalem lay in ruin. He's gone from Shushan the palace under the authority and direction of King Artaxerxes to go back and rebuild the city walls and remove the reproach of the people of God. And so he went back and the building project began full circle. From the sheep gate, families within the city, people in the towns surrounding the city, the people of God all come together from the call of God by the man of God, and they respond. And in unity, they begin to build the wall of the city of Jerusalem. And that's where we come to today, as this building project is going on around the entire city simultaneously. And we see in these first 3 verses of chapter 4, what I have said over and over again. When the man of God or the people of God, when they stand up to be obedient to the word of God and to obey the Lord and his command, there will always be opposition from the evil one. Satan always stands opposed to the work of God. He always has and he always will. It happened then and it happens today. Until God puts him in his proper place in the lake of fire. He will always stand opposed. So the enemy attacks. And we see in these first 3 verses, the attack comes through the form of ridicule. It came to pass, verse 1, that when Sanballat heard that we builded the wall, he was wroth and took great indignation. And he mocked the Jews. In chapter 2 and verse 10, the first mention of this Sanballat and his cronies, it says that they were grieved that when Nehemiah came, because someone came to seek the welfare of the children of Israel, which they hated. And then chapter 2, verse 19, the same Sanballat and his cronies, they laughed us to scorn and despised us, Nehemiah said. And now they're wroth, and we'll see that again in verse 7. They're wroth that the work of God is going on. Satan hates the people of God because he hates God. And more specifically, he hates the second member of the Holy Trinity, the Son of God, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Isaiah the prophet, in chapter 53 and verse 3, he prophesied about the coming one, and he said that he is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and we hid as it were our faces from him. He was despised and we esteemed him not. And Jesus, when he took his disciples, and at the end of his earthly ministry, as it approached the finality of it, and what God had sent him to do and to purchase our salvation, he writes and he tells in Luke 18, verse 31, he tells his disciples, he took the 12 and said, "Behold, we go up to Jerusalem, and all things that are written by the prophets concerning the Son of Man shall be accomplished," Isaiah 53 being one of them. "For he shall be delivered unto the Gentiles, and he shall be mocked and spitefully entreated and spitted on, and they'll scourge him and put him to death, and the third day he shall rise again." That's the hatred of the world for our blessed Savior. I've been ridiculed and mocked for being a Christian, but nothing like that. And it's hard. It's hard when you're attacked for the only reason being that you're a child of God. They were being attacked. They were doing nothing wrong. They were simply obeying the Lord. But that's the work of Satan. In this fallen world, we will be attacked. We will be mocked for our faith. And so, the attack continues in verse 2. "And he spake before his brethren and the army of Samaria." So there's an army that stands against the people of God now. "And said, what do these feeble Jews?" I have been told before, only a weak person needs a Savior. You ever heard that before? Only a weak person needs God. That's your crutch. You can't hack it. Can't hack it in the world, so you got to have a crutch. You're too weak to handle it on your own. Praise the Lord, I'm weak. That's me. I'm weak. And I got news for you, Buster. Whoever you may be, smart aleck, you're weak and you're too afraid to admit it. Because we're all weak. Who's in control? Is any of us in control of our life? Nobody. And Granny, you mentioned last week that death, it's that great equalizer. And nobody can escape it, can they? Can't get away from it. I don't care how rich you are, how famous you are, whether you're a prince or you're a pauper. Death comes for all. And then all must give account to God. All will stand before Jesus Christ. All and every knee will bow. I bow to him on the earth. If you don't bow to him on this earth, you will bow to him in the judgment, but it'll be to your condemnation. Mm-hmm. not to your salvation. But what are these feeble Jews? Well, Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 1 that God's chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise, and he's chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty. That's why I'm in the pulpit today. Why? That no flesh should glory in his presence. That according as it is written, he that glorieth, let him glory in the Lord. Ain't nobody getting no glory around here but the Lord. He gets all the glory. And then they mock. They're weak. What? Are they gonna fortify themselves? What can they do? Weak, pathetic Christians. Can't hack it. Got to have their crutch. No, they mocked him. Will they fortify themselves? Well, they were weak. Absolutely. So are we. But Paul said in 2 Corinthians 12:9, the Lord's answer to his prayer request was, "My grace is sufficient for thee. For my strength is made perfect in weakness." Amen. His strength is perfected. The story of Gideon, too many Gideon, too many. Okay, 300, that's about right. Ain't no way anyone's going to get the glory for this but me. And he took care of it, didn't he? That's the Lord. It's the Lord's work. So, will they sacrifice? Will they begin to worship God? Will they make an end in a day? What do they think they can accomplish anyways? Well, Philippians 4:13 says, Paul tells us that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Will they revive the stones out of the heaps of the rubbish which are burned? Remember, the city and the city walls were completely destroyed. The gates burned. Nehemiah, in chapter 2, verse 13, when he went out by night, he viewed the walls of the city that were broken down and the gates that were burned. Everything in a heap of rubble and ashes. What do they think they can do? Well, the prophet Isaiah says in 61:3 that he gave them beauty for ashes. What God can do, there's no limit. Oh, yes. Oh, yes, they can. They can raise up those walls out of the charred remains and the broken stones. Why? Because God is the one that enables. And it's his call. It's his work. Is it any great thing for God to take out of the rubble and raise up those city walls? When Ephesians 2 chapter 1 says that you and I have been quickened, have been made alive when we were dead in our trespasses and sins. Lazarus raised from the dead was a type of salvation. No more could Lazarus respond than by the power of God when Jesus said, "Lazarus, come forth." And you and I, when we were dead in our trespasses and sins, and we heard the gospel call, and our blessed Savior said, "Come forth." And we came out of the grave of our spiritual deadness into new life in Jesus Christ. Amen. We're saved because of his strength. Amen. We're saved because of his grace. And whenever these old rascals, when they chime in on you, I've noticed that there's always some coward that's in the background that wants to join in on the crowd. Once they see which way the crowd's going, then they go that way. I think that's what this old Tobiah guy is. Tobiah the Ammonite. So he hears Sanballat with his big talk and his accusations and his mockings, and he sees it's going pretty well. So he wants to join in, get on the act. And he adds, and even that which they build, if a fox go up, he shall break down their stone wall. Smart aleck. Adding to it, he's a coward. But that's the way of the world. That's Satan's crowd. Jesus said in Matthew 5:10-12, blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when men shall revile you and persecute you and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice, Jesus says, and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets which were before you. And not only did they persecute the prophets, but they persecuted the Son. Luke 22:63 and the following, the men that held Jesus, they mocked him and smote him. And listen, just try to picture this band of vile soldiers, ungodly, wretched men. And they mocked Jesus, smote him, blindfolded him, and struck him on his face, and said, prophesy, who smote thee? And many other things blasphemously spake they against him. And what did Jesus say to those soldiers when he hung on the cross? Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. And he tells us in John 15:20, that the servant is not greater than his Lord. If they persecuted me, they will persecute you. We know that standing with our blessed Savior is going to cost us. If you stand for Christ, you will be persecuted for the cause of Christ and for the name of Christ. If it happened to our Savior, he says it will happen to you. And it's happening here to Nehemiah and these faithful ones that are doing the work of God in Nehemiah's day. So how does Nehemiah respond? It's a very interesting response. We know that Nehemiah is a man of prayer. We've seen this over and over again. The verses 4 and 5, Nehemiah prays. And it's an interesting prayer. He says, hear, O our God, for we are despised, and turn their reproach upon their own head, and give them for a prey in the land of captivity, and cover not their iniquity, and let not their sin be blotted out from before thee, for they have provoked thee to anger before the builders. We know the promise given in Genesis 12:3 to Abraham, I will bless them that bless thee and curse him that cursed thee, and in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed. And so they're cursing the people of God, Abraham's seed. And Nehemiah goes back to the covenant promise in Genesis 12:3 and said, Lord, they're persecuting us. They're cursing us. And he says, so curse them. They call these imprecatory psalms. There's a multitude of them when you read them. And these are the prayers for God's judgment on the ungodly. Maybe a little uncomfortable, when we read them. Psalm 74, 22. Arise, O God, plead thine own cause. Remember how the foolish man reproacheth thee daily. Forget not the voice of thine enemies. The tumult of those that rise up against thee increaseth continually. You hear the theme in the prayer of the psalmist? It is the reproach of the glory of God that he's praying. Your glory, Lord, is being reproached. Psalm 79, verse 10 through 12. Wherefore does the heathen say, where is their God? Let him be known among the heathen in our sight by the revenging of the blood of thy servants, which is shed. Let the sign of the prisoner come before thee. According to the greatness of thy power, preserve thou those that are appointed to die. And render unto our neighbors sevenfold into their bosom their reproach, wherewith they have reproached thee, O Lord. They reproach God. And the psalmist says, return it on their own heads sevenfold. And then we come to the New Testament. And Jesus says, Matthew 5:44, I say unto you, love your enemies. Bless them that curse you. Do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you. And Paul goes on that theme in Romans chapter 12, verse 14 and following. Bless them which persecute you. Bless and curse not. Verse 19, dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves, but rather give place unto wrath, for it is written, and that's Deuteronomy 32, 35. It is written, vengeance is mine. I will repay, thus saith the Lord. Therefore, if thine enemy hunger, feed him. If he thirst, give him drink. Verse 21, be not overcome of evil, child of God, but overcome evil with good. Now there's a great conflict within my soul. I don't have any problems praying the imprecatory prayers. I'm with Nehemiah on that. Get him, God. Get him. But we see the heart of our blessed Savior and telling us to have that sacrificial agape love of God in our hearts, even for our enemies. I'm not going to lie to you. I have a hard time with that. Amen. That's hard to reconcile. I'm just being honest. What good does it do for me to stand up here and tell you? I know what God's word says to do, but it's hard. I cannot do this in my own strength. I cannot love my enemies unless God, by his divine power and the divine love that he's given me, gives me that capacity and the strength to do that. I cannot do that on my own. But Nehemiah's prayer is centered on the glory of God that is in reproach. It's not about me, and it's not about you, but it's about God's glory. And when we see this going on all around us in our society and in our government, mocking the name of God, I tell you what it should do. It should break our hearts that the glory of God is being reproached. But that vengeance, that's his. That's not ours. Give that to the Lord. God will take care of it. Either by saving that wicked sinner like you and I were
and still are, by his marvelous grace, or he'll deal with them in his judgment. He'll take care of it. One way or another, all debts will be paid. All accounts will be settled. He'll make everything right. He's going to fix it all. One way or another. Either vessels of his mercy and grace, or objects of his divine wrath. It's in his hands. It's not our responsibility. So, verse 6. After you pray, God, they're opposing us. They're mocking your name. There's nothing we can do about it. So we're putting it in your hands. And then what did they do? They rolled up their sleeves and they got to work. They prayed and then they got to work. So they built we the wall, and all the wall was joined together unto the half thereof. For the people had a mind to work. Now make note of this, because we're going to see this next week. The wall is only half completed. The circle is fully completed, but the city wall has only been built up to half of its height, and the project is not done yet. They're in the middle of this project, but here we see that it was built halfway up, full circle of it. Why? Because the people had a mind to work. And Christians today, as Paul exhorts the church in 1 Corinthians 1:10, I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you all speak the same thing, that there be no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment, to have the same mind, and then do the work in unity. In Philippians 1:27, let your conversation be as that becometh the gospel of Christ. That's all we have to offer. That's what we need to share. Not our rebuke, not our attacks, not defending ourselves, but our defense is the gospel of Jesus Christ. To give the gospel, let our conversation be as becometh the gospel of Christ, and stand fast in one spirit with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel. In Philippians 1:28, Paul adds, and in nothing terrified by your adversaries. Don't let them get to you. Don't be terrified by your adversaries, because it is to them an evident token of perdition. They are the ones that are in trouble. They are the ones that are facing the wrath of God. Don't be terrified by them. Be terrified for them. But to you and I, salvation, and that salvation is of God. And now, these last few verses, 7 through 9. Back to the enemy now. They're building. The mocking hasn't worked. They're of one mind. They're obedient to the Lord. So now, old Sanballat and his cronies, once again, now they're conspiring. It just keeps increasing. The persecution is increasing and increasing, and we're going to see it continue to increase. It came to pass in verse 7, and I'm going to give you some directions that they're coming from now. When Sanballat from the north, and Tobiah from the east, and the Arabians from the south, the Ammonites from the east, and the Ashdodites from the west now, the new enemy added to the group of cronies. North, south, east, and west, surrounded by the enemy. And when they heard that the walls of Jerusalem were made up and that the breaches began to be stopped, they were very wroth. And they conspired, all of them together, to come and to fight against Jerusalem and to hinder it. Do you think they were allies before Jerusalem started building? That part of the world, anybody, hey, I've lived there for over a year to combined. I'm telling you, no wonder they fight. That's a horrible place. The whole Middle East, man, that's hot and miserable. And they love to fight. They're all fighting amongst themselves all the time. Whoa, such unity of these wicked men. How can there be so much unity? I'll tell you why. Because who they're going up against. And look, they're going in direct contradiction to the king of Persia, the ruler of the known world, Artaxerxes, who said to build this wall, for the Jews to build this wall. While they're opposing him in their hatred for the Jewish people. But he's 1,100 miles away, Artaxerxes is. But where's God? He's right there. He ain't gone nowhere. He's right there with them. Well, the psalmist again in Psalms 2, verse 1. Why do the heathen rage? The people imagine a vain thing. The kings of the earth set themselves and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed, saying, let us break their bands asunder and cast away their cords from us. They're united against God and the people of God and the Son of God. Why, what a threatening crowd that must be when all the kings unite against God. You know what the psalmist says? In verse 4 of Psalms 2, now they're gathered together, all of them united against God. I love this. It says that he that sitteth in the heavens shall laugh. The Lord shall have them in derision. Do you think Armageddon is going to be any problem for the King of Kings and Lord of Lords? Speak, it's gone. Rising up, all the nations of the world, rise up. He laughs them in derision. Man, we're on the Lord's side. He can never fail. He must prevail. He'll never fail. Have faith in God. Have faith in God. But see, Jesus Christ, by his Holy Spirit, he unites the saints of God, right? We've read that. They, in unity, they built. But you know who else Jesus Christ unites? He unites his enemies together. All the gospel message here, Matthew 16, verse 1, the two groups that hated each other, that competed for the rule of Israel, amongst the Sanhedrin, the Pharisees, and the Sadducees, opposed to one another, like oil and water. But guess what? The Pharisees, with the Sadducees, came tempting him. Mark 3, 6. And there was a third group, the Herodians, the political scoundrels of the day. Well, they were ungodly. And they were completely opposed by the Pharisees and the Sadducees. But here we see that the Pharisees went forth and straightway
took counsel with the Herodians against Jesus and how they might destroy him. Enemies united. And Pilate and Herod. Luke 23:11. Herod and with his men of war set Jesus at naught and mocked him and arrayed him in a gorgeous robe, and they sent him back to Pilate. And the same day, Pilate and Herod were made friends together, for they were at enmity between themselves before. The hatred of Christ united them as well. And the Acts 4:26, the kings of the earth stood up, and the rulers gathered together against the Lord and against his Christ. The Pharisees, the Sadducees, the Herodians, Pilate, Herod, the Romans, the Jews, everyone. They were united against Christ. For of a truth, against that holy child Jesus, whom thou hast anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate with the Gentiles and the people of Israel, they were gathered together to kill him. But Peter adds, for to do whatsoever thy hand and thy counsel determined before to be done. Because why did Christ come? Why did he come? He came to die. He had to die on that old Roman cross. He purchased our sin debt. He died for our sins. But their hatred is what united them. They thought, Satan thought, that he was gaining the final victory by killing the Son of God. But when Christ rose from the dead, actually, when he died for our sins, and the proof of that purchase was that he rose from the dead, it was Satan's ultimate defeat. Because he lives, will face tomorrow. Nevertheless, verse 9, we made our prayer unto our God, and we set a watch against them day and night because of them. Because of who? Because of the enemies. They prayed and they watched. Well, does that sound familiar? Nehemiah, a man of prayer. To pray and to watch. That's our charge, Christians. In this perverse and wicked generation in this world, pray and watch. The psalmist, Psalm 50:15, call upon me in the day of trouble. I will deliver thee, and thou shalt glorify me. Jesus, Mark 13:33, tells us, take ye heed, watch and pray, for you know not when the time is. And Paul adds to the church, Colossians 4:2, continue in prayer and watch in the same with thanksgiving. To watch and to pray. Now, remember I said they're surrounded north, south, east, and west. I preached a sermon sometime back on Isaiah 41:10. Fear thou not, God says, I'm with thee. Be not dismayed. I am thy God. I will strengthen thee. I will help thee. I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. I'm not going to break that down this morning. But he is over us. He's under us. He's around us. He's beside us. He's within us. He's got us, right? Amen. We're wrapped in triple deity, sealed by the Holy Spirit, wrapped in the hands of Jesus, in the hands of the Father, and Jesus and the Father are one. He's got us. And Isaiah 43:1, thus saith the Lord that created thee, O Jacob, and he that formed thee, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed thee. I have called thee by name, thou art mine. And we are children of God by faith in Jesus Christ. He's called us by name, and he says, you are mine, child of God.
God says, you're mine. I've redeemed you. You're mine. And even though, as Paul says in 2 Corinthians 4, 8 through 10, even though we're troubled on every side, yet we're not distressed. We're perplexed, but we're not in despair. We're persecuted, but we're not forsaken. You understand that? Not forsaken. He's still got us. We're cast down, but we're not destroyed. Always bearing about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our body. Live our life for Christ, regardless, come what may. Watch and pray and live our lives for the Lord, because He's got us. And He who began a good work in you and me, He'll perform it till the day of Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Father, again, thank you for your holy word, and thank you for these that are here. I pray, Lord, as you have applied your holy word to my heart by your Holy Spirit, I pray that you also apply that word to the hearts of these, my listeners. May we be obedient to your word. May we be yielded to the Holy Spirit and be a light that shines even in the midst of persecution, that the whole world may see that Jesus Christ is Lord of all. Help us, Lord, to do your will. And may you have your way in this invitation. Whatever the need is, Father, meet that need in Christ. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand and we'll sing.